Okay. Hello and welcome to my talk, Compound Time Regular Expressions. This talk is new and I made give it last week on CPP Now. It's shorter version and I hope you will like it. First thing, I'm Hana Dusíková. I'm a researcher in Avast and my things I'm doing is improving things I found in our code base and do high performance stuff. Also, I'm organizer of Avast C++ Prague meetup. If you heard it, maybe not. It's a public meetup with all our streams, so you can watch them. And I'm also Czech national body in ISO C++ committee. Okay, sometimes I'm occasional hiker. Depends if I remember my last talk or not. And also I like to take photographs. And because I don't have time, I need to read my books very quickly. Okay, feel free to tweet. Oh, sorry, core CPP, sorry. We start with this quote. You will feel the same. Okay, first thing, I'm going to talk about compound time regular expression library. Maybe you heard about it. How many people heard about CTRE library? Okay, nice. First thing, first example, basic usage. You have function, which you call match function, and with some regular expression pattern, and against your input, and it returns bool, true or false. I think it's pretty simple. Another example. Extracting value from your input. For example, this function extracts SHA256 from your input with match function, your pattern. And if it's successful, it returns string view over the regular expression, over the SHA, or null opt. Okay. Another example, extracting a date from your input. If you want to parse date, you extract year, month, and day with structure bindings. And if you are successful, you can do something with this value. Otherwise, they are empty. You can iterate over your input, like reading all with range function, like reading all numbers, comma separated. And then you extract the value of the number and convert it into integer and return output. The library also supports Unicode. In ConsExpr, it takes Unicode string, property class from Unicode, and you can do static assert, and it's working. It's not fully merged into main branch, it's in a different branch if you want to experiment with it. And thanks to Corentin Jabot for providing Unicode ConsExpr table. Okay. There is an example in Godbolt. We have fast match function, which is the FA based matcher, which takes Aloha or A to Z star. And this is the whole assembly it generates. It's only 17 lines of assembly. Question?
What is the exact difference between match and fast match?
Match is backtracking based and fast match is DFA based, and I'm talking about DFA based matching only on this talk. Fast match will generate much bigger codes. Wait a sec. 44 lines of assembly. But because I have time constraints, I cannot go to both matchers, so I'm going only into DFA one. Okay, features of CTRE. It's PCRE to compatible dialect. I'm going to change it into ECMAScript soon. It has basic Unicode support, and it's optimizing greedy cycle into possessive one in backtracking meshing. And, sorry? Okay. Okay. There are always some problems. No, I cannot. It's disconnected. Because, yeah. It's first time conference. It always some problem. So, no problem. I'm actually quite okay if it's not recorded. So I should continue? Okay. It's context sperm. And the pattern is constructed during compilation. Also, you can do context sperm and runtime matching. But you cannot change your pattern in runtime. I don't think it's a problem for most of us, because how many of you needed to change pattern in runtime? One. What did you do? Okay. If you are using user-provided input, are you concerned with security problems? Are you, do you have any problem with security? Yeah. Yeah. If you use, for example, PCRE library, you have security problems in your program. PCRE library is from parallel compatible regular expression, and it gives you there are security problems in parser of the regular expression. So if your user provides specially crafted regular expression, it gives you stack overflow and stuff like this. Also, it does quick regular expression matching and searching, and supports structure binding and generates compact assembly. Technical details. It's small header-only library, only 8,000 lines. Supports all major compilers, Clang, GCC, and MSCC. It's open source with Apache 2 license. And it's available on GitHub. That's motivation for this talk. And I will explain how it works. OK, regular expression. How many of you at least once in their career used regular expression? OK, nice. So regular expression formally are defined as empty set, which doesn't accept anything, empty string, which accepts only empty input, literal char as A or something else, or concatenation of two regular expressions, or alternation of two regular expressions, or repetition of regular expression. This is like a recursive definition of regular expression. You know, there is non-formal constructs like optional, which is just epsilon or something, or plus repetition, which is A concatenated with A star. Also, we have bug references. Do you see a problem with bug references? It's not regular, correct. Why? Yeah, it's not regular technically. It's a different level of language. But you can convert all non-regular forms into regular one. All formal into non-formal to formal one. Like this. And CTR, regular expression itself is abstract syntax tree of operation of regular expression. So we have alternation, concatenation, and so on. So we have tree. The expression is a tree. How do we store it? We can allocate tree-like structure, but we cannot. In context, you cannot allocate anything yet. But you can store a type-based something into expression templates or tuple-like empty types. I will show you how. We have struct epsilon, struct char, struct concat, and so on and so on. And you can combine them into the tree.
like this. We have regular expression, CT, optional, RE, and we have concatenation of optional, and so on and so on. So if we go with here, with core CPP, we have regular expression for core CPP. Or we can go CPP or HPP. It's JavaScript, actually. Okay, how do we convert pattern into the AST in compilation time? We need to convert string into type. We use generic LL1 parser for converting pattern into a type. The parsers use PCRD compatible grammar, as I said before. Output type is AST, and how does LL1 parser work? Is there anyone who programmed LL1 parser in their life? 1, 2, 3, okay, 4, okay, 5. Okay, LL1 parser is a relatively simple construct which takes start symbol on the stack, so there is a stack. On every step, it pops the symbol from the stack and checks current char on input tape. And based on the pair, it decides what it's going to do. Push something on the stack. Pop something from the input. Move to next char. Or reject in the input. And in case, empty stack and empty input, we are accepting. So this is a table for regular expressions in LL1 grammar. The table takes symbol from the input, symbol on the stack, and decides if it push something, if it push empty string, which is also thing, if it pop current input to next char, or it reject or accept. This is table for simpler expression like grammar. In the library, it's much more complex. Okay, this is a demo for LL1 parser. And I can show how the parsing is working. It takes char A and it see there is a symbol S on the stack, so it push other mode sequence alternation. And so on, it do the parsing. It looks complex, but if you look, for example, for a regular expression like this, you can see how it builds the tree inside and expecting closing parentheses, and then eating them. And at the end, it accepts. If there is missing closing parentheses, it tries to parse them, and suddenly there is missing one, and it rejects. Okay, how can I represent the symbols in the C++? I will use empty type, because empty type is a named something which is not closed set. In this case, there is a symbol for start symbol, alternation, module, sequence, and so on. There is special alias for start symbol, so the parser knows what symbol is starting. Also, how we need to express the table somehow for C++ to use it in compilation time. We will use function overloading. So symbol and char, which is pushing something, is just function without body, which takes symbols, term, and give me list of symbols I'm returning. If I find something on stack and an input, I just pop it if it's same. If it's something else, sync, with low priority, I will reject. And if I have some special symbol for empty stack and epsilon, it accepts. Okay, how can I repass the grammar into parser? We cannot just give something like a bunch of structs to template, for example. We need to wrap it into another struct. Okay, the parser is used like this. We have parser, which take grammar, input, and return if it's correct or not. This is feature of C++20. You can use string as a template argument in C++20. parser implements it takes grammar and calls function f from the grammar, which decides the rules or during the parsing. It takes top of the stack and current term. Okay, fixed string is from paper 732 from Jeff Snyder and Louis Dion. And they show how you can implement fixed string for C++ and the feature of class non-type tuple parameters, which I'm using. It's, there is some bunch of constructor, and there is an operator which takes some symbol from the nth symbol from the string, and so on, so on. And there is CNDTP, which creates right size of the string into the type. Okay, how do we implement stack? We cannot allocate. This is the simplest stack you can implement in compile time in C++. It's just empty type with arguments. You can push something, which will take the stack and something you're pushing and it return new stack. You can pop something which take stack and return stack minus one element. You can top, like check what's on the top, which will return symbol, and in case the list is empty, it returns empty special symbol, it's empty. Okay, how does it fit together? We have stack, we have string, and so on, so on. There is a parser in one slide. You get two grammar, two parameters, grammar and fixed string, and call function parse with the start symbol on the stack. There is also function get char, which take char from the input as the template argument, decide if it's inside of the boundaries of the string, and return the term, or return epsilon if it's empty already. If we are beyond the size of the string. Okay, we call function parse with the stack and size position. Yeah. We look on the top of our stack, we look on current char, we look on into our grammar, what we are going to do. And based on that, we create next move, which is empty object, empty type, and we call function move with our next stack, like stack without the current element. And function move, if we are pushing something, which is list of something, we just call parse function again. And if we are popping input, we call parse with position plus one. We are moving to next char. And if we are rejecting, we return false. And same for accept, but we are returning true. Okay, but we need to more than just boolean. We need to create a type. How can we build a type from a string? We have the grammar here, but we need to enhance it, augment it with something. We create some new symbols, this one, just so-called semantic actions. And whenever we run into them during parsing, we do something. We modify some subject somehow. So we need these symbols, somehow mark them. So we have empty struct tagged with inheritance. So they are different than ordinary non-terminals. Okay, we have parser as before. But currently, output is a pair of inputs. So we are pushing a start symbol as a stack and subject, which is something, a template argument. And then we parse it. And we are pushing two arguments, stack and subject. We look on top of symbol on our stack. And if it's semantic action, we check previous char. Modified somehow based on our semantic action. We are using function overloading again, and then we check the type, create empty instance because there is no value inside it. It's just a type, and then we create object and call parse function again recursively. In case nothing changed, we just call parse function again with current subject. And we need to push subject through our move function. So if we are pushing something, we just return it. Same thing if we are popping something, we are just returning. And same thing for accepting, rejecting, it's same. At the end, we can check if correct. We are providing our subject is empty list, empty stack. And output type is just a result of the parsing of our subject, which originally was empty stack. Because you can manipulate with stack somehow. Okay. Okay. This is the AST graph of, for parsing of expression A star B star. And the colorful squares at the bottom are semantic actions. Semantic actions modify stack with postfix notation. So if you have A here, you push A on the stack. If you have star, you push star, but star is special action, and it's defined that it takes one symbol from the stack, wrap it into itself, and return star A. Then we push B and star, wrap it star, and concatenation will take two elements and wrap them in different order, and we have concatenation star char A star char B. If we change it to something differently, we can go another course CPP. It's too long. We should take a shorter name. Yeah. Okay. It's too long. Okay. Okay, how the modify function looks like? Looks like this. If you get char action, you just take previous char term something A or C at the beginning, whatever, and push it on the stack. Because there is a stack, the list is the stack. If we have action sequence, which is doing concatenation, I forget to rename it, you take two elements from the stack and wrap them into concatenation sequence in different order, because on the stack they are different otherwise. Same thing, if you are pushing something into existing concatenation, you just take symbol concatenation, and return concatenation and symbol as one. Yes, Jason?
Each of these functions, the modified functions, those are functions, right?
Yeah, these are functions.
Returning return types. What is the actual body of this function look like?
There is no body. There is no definition, only a header of the function.
But you do call the functions, right?
I'm calling them in the decal type. So I'm calling them in the local type. I don't need actual implementation of the function. I need just header.
So they're just overloading.
Yeah, just overload mechanism to decide what's going on next.
It's just local type, but could you implement it in such a way that it returns just a default construction
yeah.
of that thing?
Yeah. Okay. I mean, I just wanted to show it. You can do it without actual implementation. Okay, if we are alternation, we take two symbols and return alternation of A to B and B. If we are pushing something into alternation, we just take something and previous alternation and wrap it together. If there is optional, we take something optional and wrap it into optional. Same thing for plus, same thing for star. Yeah. It's just wrapping. Okay, so we have AST, core, CPP, and it's beyond the screen, sorry. But if you copy this code, it will work. Yeah, this is the AST representation of the template, and this is a string. Okay. Yeah, and you need to check, because you return type of the parser is a vol stack, and you need to check top element of the stack. So there is function top. Okay, we have AST. We need to match it somehow. We need finite automaton. Finite automaton is five tuple. Finite set of states. It's finite set of input alphabet. Transition function from states with alphabet into another state, or states. We need start state somehow marked. And we need a set of final states. Okay. By the way, finite automaton can parse regular expressions, exactly the same class of language. Okay, let's have finite automaton which take 0 to 9 plus. We have start state, which is marked with an arrow, and in case we get 0 to 9, we are going to another state. The final state is marked with, it's marked, and that is a cycle if we are continuing. So, this automaton doesn't accept empty state, but if we provide some input, it accepts. But if I want negative numbers, it doesn't work, it doesn't accept. So we need to somehow modify it. We add a special state, which take minus, and then is going to back to final state. So now it's accepting. If we want decimal numbers, it doesn't accept. So we need to modify it again. Oh, sorry. Now, okay. Sometimes they entangle. So we have a finite automaton which take integer dot and another number. What if we want scientific numbers? Like this. We need to modify it again. We have automaton which take scientific numbers. So you can see there is some sort of mapping between regular expression and finite automaton. So, how do we convert regular expression into finite automaton? First example, we have automaton which doesn't take anything. There is no final state. This automaton will take only empty input. This automaton will take only char A. And this automaton is special one. It's with epsilon epsilon transition, which take nothing or A. It can be also expressed differently with first state optional, but I wanted to show epsilon state because we will use them later. I can show it. We have nothing, which accept, and suddenly our automaton is in two states at once. It works like this. If you are in one state and there is epsilon transition, you are going even into second state, but you are keep staying in the first state too. So you can be in multiple states together, which is called non-deterministic finite automaton. Okay, we have two automatons. One takes A, one takes B. We need to combine them to automaton which takes A or B. So we need to connect them somehow. We create a new state and a few epsilon transitions. Like this. You have automaton which takes A or B. A or B. But at the beginning, we are in three states, but none of them are final one. Okay, we disconnect them again, and we want to concatenate them. So we need to concatenate all final states from the first automaton on the left and connect them into second automaton on the right. So we connect final states from A to start state of B. But final states of A cannot be no longer final. So we connect them. We have automaton which take A, B sequence. Okay. In some cases, if there is, for example, a cycle at the final state in on left automaton and something on the right state, you can mix them up. So it's better to use epsilon state, epsilon transition, and then use epsilon transition algorithm removal. I will show later. This is cycle, clean star, which takes sequence of AB star, like nothing, AB, 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 and so on, so on. AB, AB, AB. Okay. But we can make it simpler one. We can remove some epsilon states easily by merging nodes. And this is the simplest one automaton which takes sequence AB. AB, AB. Okay. So we probably understand finite automatons now, at least somehow. Okay, so there is direct mapping between operation over finite automatons and definition of regular expressions. So there is concatenation operation for regular expression and concatenation algorithm for finite automatons. So we just need use the AST and map the action over the AST into algorithms over finite automatons. Yeah. Okay, we need a definition of our finite automaton somehow in C++ because we are no longer in formal land. Finite set will be set of int. Make sense? Because state is just number. Our alphabet will be char 32, which is a superset of all char types in C++. And transition function is a tuple from source state to target state with some symbol, and that's all. Start state is always zero. Make it easy. And final states are set of integers. Do we need the set of ints at the beginning? Who think we need first set in our definition? Yeah, but yeah, you are correct. But also, these states are already in our transition function. We actually don't need to know if they are existing. So we don't need this set, and we just use it as a value of our state. Okay, constexpr. We need to implement it in constexpr. As Chandler said, there is no zero cost abstraction. Maybe you will be scared soon. Constexpr problems. How many of you tried to write something in constexpr? Okay. Did you run into some problems? Okay. Every operation counts. Every operation you do, it counts you something. There are limits in different compilers. There are different ones. For example, in GCC, you can use only 250,000 cycles. And in Clang, you can do 1 million of expressions. It's hard to implement something which is supposed to be working on both compilers, by the way. Move semantic doesn't matter, because you cannot allocate, so you cannot return pointer. You need to copy everything. Because everything in constexpr is a value. Also, you cannot easily report problems, and you cannot easily debug. You can use conditional EUB or throw statement as a form of assert. If you run into EUB or throw, it will give you nice error to your compiler. And you can use principle-style debugging. How many of you use principle for debugging? More. I know you are everyone. If you instantiate this type without any definition, it will give you error. You cannot instantiate type, identify type, and your type you are looking for. Okay, another deconstexpr problem. It's slow. You maybe have no idea how it's slow. So I implemented the determination of finite automaton as algorithm, and for some big regular expression, I tried 2 minutes. In GCC 9.9. 40 seconds, same regular expression in Clang. Less than 5 seconds. Not in MSVC, in PHP. PHP doesn't play that they are not interpreted language. They know they are interpreted language. So they are okay with it. Okay, constexpr set. It's easy data, relatively simple data structure, which have some iterators. You can look how many items are there. You can check, access some end element. You can insert something. You can erase something. It's constexpr construct. Do you see problem with it? Yeah, there is a problem. How can I can create something. Allocate something, it must be fixed set. You need to know capacity of the set before you use it, which is like common theme of context-aware programming. You need to know how much space you need. Okay, finite automaton. Transition is just struct of source, target, term. It's hidden beyond constructor, so I can change the implementation. And there is a function match, which try some char against my char and return true false. And finite automaton itself is template, which takes two arguments, size of transition and size of finite state. And we have set of transition and final states, nothing else. Okay, basic building blocks. Empty finite automaton is just finite automaton without any transition and finite state. Zero, zero. Epsilon, which take only empty input, is finite automaton with one final state. And if you want finite automaton which take char, you need one transition, which is here, and one empty state. So we have basic building blocks for our regular expressions. We need to do only manipulate the algorithms with them. So we have two algorithms, two automatons. One is ABC with some repetition, and there is XYZ, and we need to concatenate them. How do we do it? States are numbers, so we need to look on the states on the left automaton, the lower one, and find the first unused state and prefix the states of the right one with this state. So it's now 3, 4, 5. Also, we remove start state from the second automaton and final states from the first automaton, and we connect them with epsilon. And there is an answer for the question why I cannot, why I'm using epsilon state. Because if there is no epsilon state, I can go B, C, X, X, and then if it's, the nodes are connected, I can go X, C, X, C, X, C. So we need to copy all transition from state 3 to state 2 to connect them properly, like this. So this automaton accepts same language. Okay. Concatenation of two finite automaton in context pro looks like this. We take automaton as an argument, template argument, right argument, and we precalculate size of transition from both automatons. We count transition from state 0 from the left automaton, because that will be the epsilon thing. And there is a prefix, we calculate the prefix, we need to prefix the states. We create our automaton which can hold all the transition and final states of final automaton. And we copy all transition from the left to the right. And we copy all transition from the, we create the epsilon connection. So for all transition from the start state of the right automaton, we just copy transition from original state and we add the prefix to, and add the transition to output. And then we copy all transition from the right prefix set. And we mark all our final states from the right into new automaton with prefix and return the automaton. And at the end, we store our automaton as a value, which is output, because final automaton for same two automaton will be always the same. So it's stored like inline variable here. Okay, other algorithms. Alternation, repetition. I'm not going to explain them because you can get notion how they work by the concatenation, because they are working exactly the same with just some minor tweet. Always precalculate size and store them in some container you cannot allocate. It will be, maybe in future you will be able to allocate and it will be much easier. Okay, we have concatenation and I have template function which apply the concatenation of two automatons recursively on my tuple or pack of the automatons. Apply the algorithms. Alternation is applied also. So I need to implement only function which take two arguments and I can apply it any number of arguments I want. And of course, star only takes concatenation of the content into store. Okay, so we have class value based template programming. It doesn't make sense. And you can do it in C++ 17 if you use const auto ampersand argument, and if you use static language of your argument. So if your automatons are named like static context per variable, you can use them in these algorithms. It looks like this. I have my final automaton, which is concatenation of A and B. It looks like calling functions. I call them compile time functions. Context per function doesn't keep const expertness of their arguments. These can. And it makes sure the value is cached also. For example, concatenation of some automaton you will do pretty often, so compiler can remember them. Because not every compiler remembers your context per calls. I think GCC does, but Clang doesn't. And it looks nice, I think. Okay, how many of you think it looks nice? Okay, like 50%. Huh? Okay, minimization. Minimization is algorithm which remove all unnecessary states from your finite automaton without changing the language which the finite automaton accepts. We have automaton, and I can say that state 0 and 1 is duplicate because they are same. Same states are if they are both final or not final, and if they have same transition into same group. I'm not going to explain it deeply. You can check Wikipedia or your computer science materials. So you can merge state 0 and 1 into 1, and suddenly you have same automaton which takes same language. I can show it to you. For example, it takes only B, and it's final. Or we can A, B. And if we merge them, it takes the same. It accepts them. Also accept them. Okay, determinization. This algorithm, which is iterative, formal implementation, because it can, if you in your automaton have more transition from same state for same char, it's problematic. You don't know where you should go, where the automaton should go. So you need to merge, create new state, which is merge of all the states by this transition. But it can generate 2n states, which can be pretty problematic. And you cannot do, every iteration can return you new automaton with new non-determinism. For in this example, we have automaton which in state 0 rotate on A, and then for char A and B goes to state 1. So you can see non-determinism between state 0 to 0 and transition 0 to 0 and 0 to 1. So we need to merge them to state 0, 1. There is no non-determinism in state 0 now. But there is non-determinism in state 0, 1, because I merge two states and create new non-determinism. So I need to merge state 1 and 2. Suddenly, the automaton is non-deterministic. But in special cases, your automaton can explode in a number of states, especially if you are doing searching, like dot star something, dot star. Okay. It can generate 2n states, and it's iterative. On every step, you don't know how big your final automaton will be. So you need to copy automaton every time, and it's slow in ConstExpr, because you cannot allocate. And it's useful to, after the algorithm to minimize it again, because it can give you much smaller automaton. Okay, we have the deterministic finite automaton. We need to match it. For example, there is function match, which takes some regular expression, and there is function search, which only difference is that it prefix and suffix it with a dot star. So you are searching for something inside of your something, so you just can use match. But in this case, the determinization algorithm explodes, because it gives you so many states. It's really slow. Okay, fast match function, which take some range on input, which is string, vector of bool, whatever. Yeah, you can do that. Okay, we provide a regular expression as the argument. We check if the regular expression is correct. Then we extract the our type from the regular expression, or AST. And then we convert it into an FA. I will show it later. Then we determinize it, minimize it, and then we call match state. First thing, we need to know how the conversion works. An FA from is just inline variable, template inline variable, which call function convert, which takes the AST on the stack, takes the empty finite automaton as the seed, and combine them recursively. If you convert them, if you run into empty empty stack, you are at the end, you just return your seed. If there is no AST, your finite automaton is just empty. If you run into epsilon on your stack, just concatenate your seed with epsilon finite automaton and recursively call it again if there is something else on the stack. If you're converting char, just have, you need char automaton, which takes one char, and do the same. You extract the char from the stack, concatenate it with your existing seed, and together, and recursively call it again. Yeah. Oh. Concatenation sequence is similar. You have sequence, you unwrap it, return on the stack, and call itself again. Yeah. If you have alternation, you look on all the options as the template pack, convert each of one as the standalone regular expression, and create alternative for all of them, and then concatenate the alternative with your seed. And then call itself again. If there is a star cycle, you need to convert the content of the AST, of the star, into automaton and then wrap it into star and concatenate it to your seed and so on. So we have AST converted into finite automaton. Okay, so we got the NFA, we determinize it somehow, we minimize it somehow, and we need to match it finally. Match function which will take the finite automaton as the argument, start state, which is defaultly zero, or current state, and pair of iterators, like where we are and where is the end. If we are in final state and we are at the end of our input, we can return true. If we are not, we return false. Then we look into first transition index, like in the set of the transition, they are sorted by source state. So they are next to each other. So I can just look for first one for the index and call function choose transition. And also I added my current state as the parameter and automaton too. Recursively call function choose transition. And in choose transition, I will take automaton, my current index, my current state, and pair of iterators again. And if we are outside of boundaries of all transition, or if we are on different states than we expect, we return false. But if we look on our transition, on our index, and try to match it, if we are successful, we move to another state, target state, and call match state again, and move to next char also on input. And if we are not successful, we choose next transition in our for our state. And if we are hit in the end, we just hit here and false. So there must be transition from our current state, or we are fails. Okay, deterministic matching takes n times t time. Dn is length of input, t is average number of transition per state. And you don't need any memory, but doesn't support any capture tracking. So from regular expression captures. It's theoretically the quickest approach to match any regular expression. It also allows working with stream data. If you have some like gigabytes of streams, you can use DFA-based matcher or NFA-based matcher. There are other matching algorithms, NFA backtracking and FA bitable backtracking. CTRE is using DFA and NFA backtracking. And I'm working on NFA bitable backtracking now. Yeah, there's missing space. And it depends on your input, on your regular expression, which one is quickest in the real world. Okay, we are going to check some assembly. This is the regex. We match A to Z, 0 to 9 plus 0 to 9. And it gives you this assembly. And it's 1,200 of lines of assembly. It's a lot of them, yeah. I'm unable to tell you which part, because if you use stutter checks in your application, you will inherit false stutter checks implementation in your program. And it's slow. I will show it in benchmark. Okay, we move forward to boost regex. For same regular expression, takes time to compile. And we have only 6,000 of regular. Yeah, it's a little better. Okay, if we use boost expressive, which use a different style of expressing the regular expression with expression templates, it gives you only a lot of 6,000 lines of assembly. Okay. If you use CTRE fast match, which is DFA based, it gives you 60 lines of assembly for this regular expression. We can change it if we. Yeah. Can you see the hello in the assembly? That is not, no, because hello is subset of A to Z star. And because the determinization algorithm removes it from the automaton. Okay. Benchmarks. I benchmark like this. I prepare my regular expression somehow. I load a file line by line. I'm emulating grep. I measure only hot section. There is some warm-up. Thank you, Bryce. And line by line, I try to search content and count the lines so I know my algorithm works same as the others. And then I return the count and I return measurement. Methodology. I did this on big CSV file, 1.3 gigabytes with 6.5 million of lines. I did median of 3 measurements, and I did on my MacBook with GCC 9.9, latest one, and Clang, latest one, in C++ 20 mode and enabled optimization at the max. This is the benchmark for a regular expression on the top. And it's not time, it's megabytes or gigabytes per second, which is more interesting. So, boost, kind of quick. CTRE, kind of fast. PCRE, yeah, it's not bad. And JIT, they are emitting assembly in your runtime. So you give it pattern and it emits assembly. So it's not secure, and in some environment you cannot do it. RE2 from Google is actually pretty good, but standard library is really slow. Because it's slow. Don't use it. Okay, that's for Clang and libc++. GCC and libc++, it's actually better than standard regex, but it's still the worst. Okay, different regular expression which use much more backtracking and there are more states. In this case, PCR JIT is much, not much, it's quicker because it's like years of work and they knew what they are doing, I'm not. But CTRE is still kind of fast. It's slower than before because there are much more states. There are much more states, so it jumps around and it can miss cache of your processor and the source code is bigger. On GCC, it's quicker than PCRE, so it depends. Okay, but about compilation time. How many of you think the CTRE is the worst for compilation time? Raise your hand. Okay. This is compilation time per library. I include all headers for all libraries into one, so it's like fair. And only compilation. It's not bad. Sorry? It grows linearly. I'm not having it as part of this talk, but in CppCon I measure it, and it like for backtracking engine, it's like 100 milliseconds per regular expression, for ordinary regular expression, not crazy one. I get in bug reports like 2,000 lines of code or something. If your regular expression is longer than 60 char, you are doing something wrong. And on GCC, stat regex is the slowest to compile, by the way. Sometime, when I tried it in Gorbolt, it's time out. Okay. Five things I showed you. How regular expression engines work. Connection between theory and code. Parsing of a pattern during compilation. Building a finite automaton. And comparison between different regular expression implementation. And you should remember at least four things from the next list. Compiler can optimize your code if you help them. You can combine template metaprogramming with constexpr and express yourself more clearly so compiler understands you and can optimize it better. And you should stop pretending constexpr C++ is compiled language. It's not. And try the CTRE library, not just for speed, but also for code clarity. Thank you. Okay, stat regex does have an option to optimize the engine somehow. I think no one implements it. I tried it, and there was no change in performance. Okay, another question? I tried JavaScript library. I don't have it in the slides. They are kind of fast. They are on like in same way as PCRE, sometimes even better. They invest a lot of time to make them optimized. Sorry, I wanted to. Other than to benchmark, I forgot. I can check later, and you can check later with me. Okay. No, it's this is C++ 20. You can do it in C++ 20. Yeah, you can compile a CTRE library in 70 mode, but you need to name your regular expression pattern as a constexpr fixed string, and name it, and then use a new name instead of the pattern as a template argument. Or you can use GNU extension with template string literals. Okay, another question? Okay, thank you.